Hello, Malty Mystiques, and thank you to Andrew Paquette for that malt mention. Introducing a whisky review, 550. And my alcoholic count on this electronic breathalyzing tester is 0.026%. Now, 0.026, in my humble opinion, that suggests that I am not inebriated. In fact, the very opposite. I don't like being inebriated. Well, drunk. But there is a risk that even a few whiskies can... Well, we can still feel sober, but in fact, we're not. Not according to one of these. These electronic gadgets are more accurate than they used to be, just like the manual versions, one of which I showed a few videos ago. And it's possibly, I mean, you can buy them on eBay, so it's possibly a good idea to get hold of one of these and keep it in your car. And even after a few whiskies and a beer and a cocktail and a wine you had earlier or whatever, a quick check before you drive. Things are tightening up globally as regards drink driving. Some countries are stricter than others. The law recently changed in Scotland, significantly lowering the tolerance limit of alcohol in the body, subject to police breath tests. A word of caution, a word of advice here is be careful if you're on medication and driving. A number of medications contain alcohol. Mouthwash contains alcohol. You may have just one drink and then wash your mouth out afterwards. You get into your car, you're not drunk, but you would fail a police breath test. The best thing to do is put your car keys away, shut the door, dim the lights, put some good music on, and pour yourself a glass of whiskey at home. A lot more people these days are drinking at home, alone or with friends. The option is yours. Make sure that if you're drinking alone, you're in good company. And make sure if you're drinking with friends, that they're not bad company. This is a blended Scotch whisky. Famous Grouse, Black Grouse. Now you get a lot of different grouses. You get the standard grouse, you get the naked grouse, the liqueur grouse, the white grouse, the snow grouse, the black grouse, the whatever you want grouse. They're all out there. Happy hunting. It is a generic blended whisky which used to have a good reputation. I can remember in the 1980s tasting it, and it was really very pleasant. In fact, it was later that when I tasted an old bottle bought at auction, funnily enough, that I could pick out actually the Highland Park in it. You will not be picking out any Highland Park in the modern blend, not in this one. It is very much a concocted and composed experience. It's pretty decent. That's why I'm reviewing it for you as a blended whisky for the price that you pay in the UK. I can't answer for what price you're paying elsewhere in the world. Some places are shockingly expensive and other places to me are shockingly cheap. Black Grouse, as the name on the label suggests, is attempting to give that darker colour experience, which at this moment in time is interpreted as sherry rich, peated and slightly smoky. There you go. And that's really what they've composed in this particular blend. When you put your nose to the glass, the first thing that you get is a great big blast of grain. That's what hits me first of all, closely followed by some reasonable toffee, some vague peat, a little bit of smoke, charcoal smoke, and a vague modern sherry syrup note. The initial nosing is not very positive. However, it's when we add the water. That's if you decide you're going to sip this whiskey. Many people buy blends to mix. If that's the case, good luck to you. It's cool. It's cool. Your choice. But probably good to add a bit of ice. But once you add a drop of water to this and give it a few minutes, you will notice quite a swift change. It's a relatively young composition of whiskies. And the first thing you notice is a little grain citrus comes through. It starts to tackle that overt grain richness. Young, very young custardy grain richness that's right in the front of the nose. It sort of knocks it back a peg or two and allows a little more of the peat, some of the graininess and a little bit of the malt element to start to show itself, although it is indistinct because there's an awful lot of blending gone into this. And when a whiskey is overblended, you start to lack definitive character and definitive points in the experience. The peat itself is becoming fresher, a little more vibrant, a little some green notes in with it. Touch of seaweed, not a lot, but there's a herbal note as well, tucked in beside that grain richness. I'm noticing partly is the corn whiskey from Column Stills, as it starts to knock back a few more pegs than before. The malt component starting to appear. To me, it's mainly tamdu, but there's others in there. And slightly indistinct, I reckon there will... It's hard to say, to be honest, because you have this sherry syrup coat over the experience, which is tending to fudge and lose the crispness of the definition of the whiskies. And have a wee quick taste, that maybe that will help. It's the grain whiskey. Corn. Not bad at all, actually. Quite palatable. But there's a kind of sourness in the development, and it doesn't really lead anywhere. It doesn't move into anything in particular, like perhaps a sweet or a savoury or a bitter, perhaps. There's very little spices going on, not a lot of finish. The finish is mainly what I would call the damp tea bag effect. But give it a few more minutes. Once it continues to settle down and open up just a little bit, it will become much more interesting. Just when you initially pour a glass, without thinking too much about it, you could knock it back in a couple of glugs, which, let's face it, most folk who buy this whiskey do that. And they'll say, well, that was a little blast of Islay, and they'll leave it at that. Now, fair enough. But for some of the more discerning malt fans who are looking for a successful blended Islay-style whiskey, really, the 12-year-old Islay Mist, you've got to hang about with that, guys. This is not in that league. But as a bits of parts whiskey, you know, put a bit of this in, a bit of that in, put that in, and this is the effect we want. Well, in that respect, you know, it fulfills its mission. That's better. That's better. There's now a slight sour citrus, grain citrus, particularly lemon. Now we're getting a little more honey point coming through. Slight touch of melon, ripe fruit, yellow fruit, apricot. I'm actually getting a few McAlany notes, possibly. But altogether, given a bit of time and a drop of water, the usual thing happens. The whiskey actually gets better, becomes more interesting. the development after the arrival gains a little bit of length, and that damp teabag note lifts off the finish. It becomes a lot lighter. There's more of a slight lapsang souchong, smoked green tea or gunpowder tea effect, which is lacking that sourness that was there when it was neat. So all in all, a significantly improved whiskey once you add a drop of water. What are we going to give it? It's a blend mark. Whoops, I'm throwing my blend, I'm throwing my malt mark cards away. 83 out of 100. It's a blend. That's what it is. Bottled at 40%, chill filtered, and a good dollop of caramel colouring added. That's what you get with blends, so I'm not going to quibble too much about that. It's a little bit dearer than your standard famous grouse, but not too much dearer. If it was even if it was an extra £10 in the bottle, I really wouldn't have bothered with it. But for a reasonable jobbing Isla style contemporary blended whiskey, well, it ticks the boxes, and that's about it. I did incidentally buy a bottle of standard famous grouse, which I'd planned to review for you, but I'm not going to review it. I'm going to give you a serving suggestion. Here we go. Let's move the black grouse out the way. I'm noticing now there's a little bit more ashiness, wood char, contemporary cask note coming through in that blend. Here we are. Serving suggestion for the famous grouse. Not too much. After all, if you add too much, you might start to taste it. Oh. Oh dear. I try not to be mean, but honestly, I will find a home for this whiskey. It will not go to waste. Yeah. Cheers, my dears. Give a good shake. Good shake. Let's shake it up a bit. Plastic, you see, plastic tumbler. In case you drop it, and then if it smashes, you won't cut your fingers picking up the broken glass. It's safer. It's more health and safety conscious. Yeah. Fruity and tonic. Yep. Lovely. But let's finish off with this black grouse. It's a whiskey that continues to change in the glass if you're drinking it neat. Not too bad, but there's a real overt ashy note starting to dominate. You'll either like it or you won't like it. Anyway, that's enough for the moment. Enough for the moment. I'm Ralphie. Thank you for watching Whiskey Review 550. I hope you found it informative, engaging, and of course, quite importantly, entertaining as well. Now, I'm being in tongue-in-cheek. I'm being light-hearted. I am not slagging off the famous grouse blended Scotch whisky. It's just that some blends are better blended with a few cubes of ice or ginger beer or Coca-Cola. And that is the merit of this Scotch whisky. Mmm. Still quite fruity in a sort of grenadine sort of way. Lovely. See you soon, mate mates.